This lecture, I want to talk more about the idea of human rights. And I want to pose three questions. One, what are human rights? Two, what role should human rights play in US foreign policy? And three, what are the principal criticisms that could be made of human rights? Let me begin with the first question. What are human rights? One simple way of answering that question is to simply point to the UN Declaration of Human Rights that was adopted in 1948. This was a list of rights that were adopted in the wake of the Second World War, and one way of thinking about them is that these rights define the minimum content of natural law to which all states' legal codes must conform. If a state is not in conformity with the rights outlined in the Universal Declaration, then that state is ipso facto illegitimate. Now, that's a very bold way of thinking about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and it is problematic for a number of reasons. One reason is that the list of rights included in the UN Declaration seem to be of a very different order from each other. Some rights are simply broad statements of commitments to human decency. Other rights seem to be components of any liberal democratic country. And still other rights seem to be highly specific and fairly controversial statements of a general aspiration. So at one level, and I will read from the list of human rights here. Article 1, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. Now, who could possibly disagree with that? But then, if you go down to some of the lower level rights, and I say lower level, I simply mean later in the document. There's no reference here to the notion that the articles 1 through 10 are more important than those between 10 and 20 or beyond 20. But look at Article 24. Everyone has the right to rest and leisure, including reasonable limitation of working hours and periodic holidays with pay. Do we want to say that a state that fails to protect Article 24, a state that fails to ensure that all employers offer their employees paid vacation, is therefore in violation of human rights, and therefore that the entire state lacks legitimacy? Now, clearly that would be absurd. So we need to have a more refined view of human rights if we're going to appeal to them to draw a distinction between a legitimate authority and an illegitimate authority, a state that deserves Westphalian respect, Westphalian non-intervention from one that doesn't. Given the sheer diversity of rights listed on the UN Declaration document, it isn't surprising that philosophers have tried to provide some clarity, some effort to draw distinctions between the more important rights and the more insignificant rights. And that quickly leads us into a philosophical debate about the nature of human rights. There are a few things to notice about rights, which we can lay down from the get-go. One, rights, and in particular human rights, are clearly meant to mark out, as it were, certain key elements of a basic human existence. Rights protect the most important features of human well-being. Rights are not there to protect insignificant features of our life. You couldn't, for example, have a right not to have a hangnail, you know, minor, trivial, irritant. Rights protect important things. The second thing to notice about rights is that they impose duties on others. Philosophers often refer to this as rights and duties are co-relative. Co-relative. Rights and duties are co-relative. My right to X imposes a duty on you with respect to X. That's what we mean when we talk about rights and duties are co-relative. The third thing to notice about rights is that rights seem to offer some protection against appeals to the general welfare. The most successful philosophical effort to put all those elements together into a clear definition comes from Joseph Raz, the legal philosopher. On Raz's formulation, person P has a right if and only if some aspect of P's well-being is of sufficient importance to justify duties on others. We will look at that definition in more detail in our discussions, but I want you to try and make sense of it and bear it in mind as you read a couple of the essays that we are reading this week. At this stage, I'm not going to go any further into the philosophical debates about the nature of rights. I want to turn to our second question: what role should human rights play in US foreign policy? Here, if you cast your mind back to our discussions of realism, you will recall that one of the definitions of realism I gave was geopolitical realism. Namely, for the geopolitical realist, the job of the US foreign policy establishment is to look after the national interest, defined narrowly in terms of the relative power of the US, and not to bother too much about humanitarian concerns, not to bother too much about human rights. That is a view of the geopolitical realist. It follows from this view that the US shouldn't pay much attention to human rights. I think one would find in the foreign policy of the Trump administration very much a geopolitical realist approach to human rights. The Trump administration doesn't set much stock on human rights. It's quite willing to form alliances and friendships with clear rights violators. Prince Salman of Saudi Arabia, the North Korean leadership, you know, clear rights violators. The Trump administration doesn't seem to care. There are other presidents who have set more stock on human rights and thought that the job of US foreign policy was to distinguish between rights protecting states and non-rights protecting states, form alliances with the good guys who are rights protectors, and target the rights violators in an effort to have them shift their policies in a rights protecting direction. My third and last question: what are the principal criticisms of human rights? I think that there are three. One, human rights are nominally universalistic, but, so critics argue, in practice, they are a components of a Western liberal worldview, and they are not as universalist as they might seem. If they were to be put in place as the basis of a universal charter, then that is essentially requiring all states in the world to adopt Western liberal practices. Critics of human rights notice that you can have a flourishing society that is that doesn't protect human rights, China, for example. And were China to adopt human rights, so the argument goes, they would jeopardize their security, they would jeopardize their economic well-being. One criticism. Second criticism of human rights is that human rights are individualistic, that they encourage individuals to think of themselves in isolation from society, that they are hostile to community and tradition. A third critique of human rights is that they are too selfish, that a society that takes human rights seriously thereby ignores considerations of aggregate welfare, that we need to think more about the good of the whole, the general happiness, and rights prevent us from doing so. That's the third criticism. We will look at all three criticisms in more detail in our online discussion.